let's go ahead and get started. So here's the plan. The plan is we are going to go through each of your underwriting models today and give you a chance to explain how you came up with the variables that you came up with regard to the factors for analyzing it, how you set up the weighting, how you, in essence, came up with everything. Okay, so you're just going to walk us through sort of step by step. Everybody has the opportunity to ask questions, that sort of thing. We're not going to go in any particular order except that RJ and Paul are going to go first.
Do we come up?
Yeah, you're going to come up. And then what you can do is go ahead and just email me your model. That way that we can pull it pretty easily on my machine. And if you dare get me infected with a virus, we will not be happy. Okay. So let's. Is everybody here? Are we still missing anybody?
Yes, Jarvis.
Yeah,
Christina.
Yeah, we're still missing a couple of people.
All right. So this is our loan underwriting decision calculator. The way we went about doing it was we used drop-down tabs here. So we set a range, and then below, we'll get into why, like what the scoring criteria was, but we just gave drop-downs, and everything just sort of populates itself. Let me see if I can get it down, just change it up. So things would change. As you can see down here, everything just sort of populates itself as we change.
Okay, so let's go a little bit slower than that. Let's start off with loan to value. Okay, so sort of explain the logic behind each of the drop downs.
Yep, here you go. I'll just pull this down here. So here's our scoring criteria based on each. So LTV, or Paul, you want to get into this, I guess.
Well, okay.
All right. Back to the criteria, but the selection for these are the criteria that we picked on the bottom here, the 10 criteria, and we did it in kind of order. The first one we did was loan to value, and second one was the debt service coverage ratio. Reason being are those are mandatory, regulated by the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency, the Treasury Department that regulates banks, and those are instituted by the banks for risk management, for credit risk, for a borrower defaulting on a loan. So those are the two that are required. And we had the highest score would be an LTV below 60, just because it's less of a risk to the lender. And then the least scoring here would be an 80 up. In those instances here, the range is from 100 to 70. And the reason we did from 100 to 70 instead of maybe 100 to 0 is we didn't want to give you a failing grade, essentially, for simply just having an 80-plus LTV loan. Because, I mean, we would still take it. We would still, you know, do the loan. It would just have worse terms, basically, higher interest rates and whatnot. So basically, the way we did this, anything over a total score of 70, we accepted. Anything below, we would decline. And then as you can sort of see from our decision-making criteria, here was sort of a table. And you know, whatever your total score was, and here, self-populated, you know, based on where it was up in these boxes. So I'll just see if I can get it down to like, we'll go up each one of the numbers, see how it is. See if I get to a failing grade here. There we go. So as you can see, it is under 70, so the decision was declined. Therefore, these cells do not get populated because it's irrelevant. The moment we go over 70, let's just try to get it like a 72 or something like that. 70. So over 70, we see it's approved because it's over 70. And here are the terms that follow the guidelines here in the basic criteria. I'll see if I can just.
Well, because you're considered a higher risk at that score based on the criteria, you're going to have higher interest rate, loan origination fees, and prepayment penalty is probably higher than with somebody who has a better credit score.
Right. So, like here, we get with these terms or with these inputs, we got a score of an 83. So, if you follow here, it's approved 8%, 8%, 1% loan origination fee, 2% prepayment penalty. And then the way we organized our calculator here was from our point of view, top being most important or highest weighted down to low, which we saw as the least important or lowest rated factors. Our highest ones, we had LTV, DCSR, credit score for the tenant. We viewed as the most important.
Right, because the credit worthiness of the tenant is where the rent we're focusing on now.
Then our next sort of middle importance here, we have loan value or loan amount, vacancy rate, LEED certification based off your sort of, you know, silver or platinum, gold, silver, top being the highest scored, not certified being the lowest scored. After that, building class, A, B, and C, property type, industrial, we viewed as the least risky, down to retail being the most risky.
In the market, as of right now, industrial seems to be the...
And then next, our two bottom here, we have debt yield ratio and the credit score for the borrower. And credit score for the borrower these days just is not as relevant as the tenant, because essentially the tenant is the one at the end of the day, you know, paying the bills. So we took that in consideration and we made the credit score of the borrower down towards the bottom and the credit score for the tenant at the top. Maybe we'll just give you another view at our scoring criteria for the different factors.
Okay, so let's open it up for questions for you guys.
Any questions?
If you ask questions, that helps you grade-wise.
You said something about the credit score not being so high of a criteria as the renter itself?
Yeah, we said the credit score for the borrower, right, as the person actually trying to obtain the loan, is less relevant than the credit score of the tenants in which you're leasing it out to. We learned in class, basically, the reason behind that was at the end of the day, the tenants are the ones that are
paying the rent. Let's put it this way. The old school of lending used to be where they focused primarily on the credit score of the borrower, whereas moving now to the creditworthiness of the tenant, because that's who generates your income. So, you know, yes, we probably could have weighted it a little higher than 5%. It is important, and it is important that they have liquid assets as well. I think that's part of the stress test now that they implement for risk management. So. We could have probably waited a little higher.
I think you guys did a great job. I'm just thinking maybe the weights could have been distributed where it would have included, maybe to a lesser degree, the borrower and more, meaning more, weighting more on the tenants, but also incorporating the borrower.
Yeah, we did. We gave a 15% weight towards the tenant, which was greater than the 5% weight towards the borrower. So right. We split them up and gave them different weights based on what people use.
So the factors that affect the interest rate and everything else, it's every factor?
Yeah, just total score.
You didn't divide this one for interest rate, this one for term, this one? Every factor affect everything?
Basically, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Your total score.
Because I did it different, that's why.
Yeah. I'm sure everyone did, you know, a little different. But any other questions, comments, concerns?
Oh, so you also waived the fixed loan origination fee for different scores, I see.
Yes, that's a typo. We had that originally. We made that change, and I did forgot to change the typo.
Loan value, I made a mistake of loan value, it should be 85%. It's 80% in the spreadsheet, so we...
I mean, 85% is pretty good. I got so far.
No, 85% is the maximum loan to value.
Yeah, the maximum I found right now is 65.
Well, according to regulation.
Yeah.
For banks. But I was just going to make one comment about LEED. again, let's talk about forward and moving forward trends. And the reason that I see the industry, and from Dr. Forgy's lectures, from one for lean, and I'll tie it into that, is because of the credit crisis from 2007, 2008, the mortgage bubble. So banks now are tightening the screws. As Dr. Forgy said, you know, they have surveillance departments that could even go that far because it's risk management against credit risk or default on a loan. So what they're doing in effect is they want borrowers to have more skin in the game or equity to lower their risk, for one. And I think based on some reading, and I'm not an expert, but they're going to be implementing probably some more regulation. One, this will tie into lead, and it totally does make sense conceptually, because as far as tenant occupancy and what we spoke about in class, I can't articulate it very well, but it makes sense. Now also, I can get into, we did include a ratio called the net yield ratio. That ratio it's used now, I believe, by commercial-backed securities, like conduit lenders use that ratio. But from the research I did, it looks like they might have a push to implement that into commercial lending in the primary market. Just something I read in doing the research. And what that basically does is, all right, I'll just finish up right now. It's just another ratio, but it's a way of measuring risk, and it's static, where what they're saying is amortization periods and interest rates, debt coverage service ratio can be manipulated, whereas the debt yield ratio cannot. But in essence, what it basically says is the debt yield is what they would get on return in the event of default. Does that make sense?
Yeah, we also have to keep in mind now with the news, the way it's going with the loans and mortgages, banks are not making money from giving loans out anymore. They're going to different factors, and companies like Rocket Launcher, Quicken Loans and stuff like that, those are the private companies that are giving home loans.
Well,
the destruction of regulation is kind of like going out.
Well, sure, of course they're still making loans.
Then that's not where the margin is anymore. They changed their portfolio for making money. It's not there.
More questions?
That's why.
So what do you think the best feature of your model is?
The best feature? I guess how everything just sort of populates itself. I mean, the whole drop-down, the reason we went with the drop-down tabs instead of just manually entering it, I guess from the lender's point of view, I guess just human error. So I guess the functionality of it, I would say, is the highlight of the.
So what do you think you would have done if you, in other words, what do you think there's, what sort of weakness do you see in the model? I mean, what would you have done differently if maybe you could have done something differently that you maybe didn't know how to do, or?
I was trying to figure out a way, I mean, I guess it's not really super relevant, but I was trying to figure out a way to conditionally format this table here so that basically not only would it pop up, self-populate these cells, but it would sort of highlight, like maybe whatever row it came up in, the font would either turn green or the border around it would also be green. But I was just having issues inputting range within if-then statements. Up here you could get away with basically, see if you can see the, with here you can basically just get away with saying, you know, greater than or equal to, the beginning of the range, like anything, just keep going down. That wouldn't necessarily work, I don't think, because you have to populate all four cells. So I was just struggling with trying to find a way within Excel to, I guess, input range
if function.
Within if-then statements.
If function.
Mm-hmm. But it was like I tried, I think it was like parentheses, the value range with a colon in between. I just, you know, I was on YouTube trying to figure it out, and I eventually just gave up. I was like, this is good enough.
Well, it looks really comprehensive. That sounds like a, I mean,
fact that you guys have outlined all of your different
areas.
It's very, very comprehensive.
Thank you. We could have spent a month on it trying to figure out the criteria, you know. I mean, there's
right.
So, I mean, we did the best we could based on the knowledge we have, which is what we've learned in class, and, you know, pick the best criteria that we thought was relevant and that maybe we could explain.
I guess another answer.
The model.
Sorry, go ahead, cut you off. Another answer to your question is something we could have done better was just, you know, maybe more ranges. It's pretty broad, you know, under a million, above 25 million, and then somewhere in between. You know, we could have done that. Maybe instead of four categories, we could have maybe done that to eight. That's one way I maybe would have changed it or added depth to it.
Yeah, no, it would have. But I mean, I think you certainly demonstrated that you understood how to create the ranges that you created, and in the sense of the process. And, you know, I understand, obviously, the complexity of, you know, as you add more ranges and that, you know, those if-then statements begin to be quite monstrous.
Yeah, it'll be, this long.
Yeah.
Just to throw it in.
No, I get it. Okay. All right. Well, thank you both very much.
Okay. You want me to exit out of this?
Or? Yeah, exit out of that, and then pull up whoever is next in my email folder. Yeah, don't save it again. Just cancel it, whatever it is. I don't know what it is. Okay, and then cancel, go up to the upper right and cancel that. Okay, now then whoever's next to my email hopper.
Should I go up this way?
Yeah, go up from you.
Kenneth. There you go.
Once you're up there, can you blow up those numbers a little bit so I can see them back there?
Zoom in.
Yeah, once you do the enable editing.
All right, so we kind of, it's pretty simple, straight to the point. I guess we kind of tried to aim at making it idiot-proof, I would say. It's the same thing with the drop-down here. The underwriter would pick the product. That changes the terms. So the box under here are the available terms that the bank is offering at that moment, and that's populated from here.
So just make sure I'm clear. So for each product type, then you have the different loan terms in terms of
right.
Everything from the interest rate to the debt service sure. coverage ratio, whatever, okay.
Right, and that box can be updated by the loan committee or head underwriter or
okay,
whatever.
So what, before you skip ahead, are you going back to walk us through what the differences are between the property types?
Sure, okay, so in my opinion, I did it kind of like you guys did based on risk a little bit. So you can see a higher risk thing would be retail, so LTV is 60% versus a multifamily, which is less risk, and you're looking at 75% there. So you can see how the numbers adjust based on risk, I guess you could say. So the underwriter would only have to really plug numbers in where the yellow is.
Gotcha.
Okay, yeah, so if you go to the
criteria for a yes, let's say.
Well, it's a 60.
Okay.
The important part is the upper portion of it, because that's the number section. So to even get to the lower point, obviously the numbers would have to work. So that's kind of like the filter, and then below that adds the second level of factors. The rate gets adjusted, which you can see here. So if someone comes to the table with a little bit more money, they can kind of buy down the rate slightly. And this is, oh no, this is the burden. And that kind of this is all auto-populated also. So a loan committee could pick the rate adjustment increment, and based on what somebody brings as far as cash, it would get adjusted. That's really it.
So talk about like the location, the condition of the property. So you've got like letter grades of C, that I'm assuming then it's like an A, B, C thing? Or?
Sure, so if someone puts in, let's say it's an A location, they would get the full 10, versus if you put an F, or D, let's say D, it wouldn't wait out. So they would really, it's just plug and play. I mean, the formulas are there, so all they have to do is put in the numbers, and the net worth has ranges, so if someone were to put in, I have 250 here, but if someone were to put in 500, well, 250 is more. So let's put in 100. One more. So the ranges are in this formula here.
What's your experience in years?
So that's like the investment experience of the borrower.
Okay.
And what is the net worth? Is that the value of the property or the person?
That's the person. So these are borrower. Those are borrower underwriting factors based on that.
Can you put in a different number than one just to show us?
Sure. Okay. So that's the same thing.
Well,
so there's a formula here, right? And you can see the range. If it equals zero, it's zero. They get 0 points. If it's between one and five, they get half. It weights it out. So it'll be half times 10. So let's say we did 10 years experience. They get 1 point. The big thing that's making this a no right now is this vacancy rate. So like, I weighted that heavily because obviously it's important. I mean, if it's vacant, it's not going to pay the bills. So.
Net, from your viewpoint and perspective, net worth. How do you define net worth?
Well, if you were to go get a commercial loan, they give you a series of questions. One of them would be your net worth. They'd ask you to put out everything you own, assets, whatever.
Right, but I'm coming from a standpoint of an equity position, liquid or
no,
assets?
No,
assets.
Liquid and assets. It's your total net worth.
Okay. I was going to make one more comment. I like the way you did the amortization periods. We thought about that. We were going to try and do that, but that looks good.
Well, the loan origination up here, too, that's kind of auto-populated. Well, it is auto-populated. So that'll throw in, if you look here, again, the head underwriter could put in what they're paying their attorney at the moment.
Can you blow that up a little bit? The font is a little small today.
Okay.
Here we go. Thank you.
So this would be, a head underwriter would put all these terms in. This is basically like the loan committee's sheet.
Yeah.
And they would put all their essentials in.
Right.
So this is what they're paying the attorney. This is the commissions they're paying to the loan officers, which
right.
you can see there. And they can change that. That can be adjusted. And then that filters into the first underwriter sheet and calculates the loan origination fees.
Gotcha.
So this sheet basically needs to be filled out beforehand by the loan committee.
And you can see here, so this number, that's the commission plus the 8,000 is your loan origination minimum. Now, obviously, they use that as a negotiation tactic. They could say, hey, it's gonna be 15 grand, but that's their minimum.
Okay. Is a loan officer like a broker, essentially?
Right, yeah.
And they,
first putting the loan together.
And they get a percentage of the total?
Yeah, they get basis points. So, and the basis points are kind of based on volume of dollars in the loan, so. They're not going to pay, you know, they're going to pay less. If it's like a $10 million loan,
mm-hmm.
they're not going to pay as high a percentage because
yeah.
they don't want to, you know what I mean? They
yeah.
don't want to pay out a crazy amount of money. So
yeah.
it adjusts in the range of based on the dollars that the loan is.
Okay.
That's and that's pulled from here, which is the loan amount. And all those numbers are pulled from these amortization. And then it auto-populates the loan origination fee in here too, so you can see the effective cost of borrowing right there.
Wow.
I take it there's a lower amortization period on a commercial loans.
I think
because
right now,
of risk.
I don't know, Dr. Forget, but I'm pretty sure most of it's 25 years is the best you can get. I don't, they don't do 30 year, unfortunately. I'm pretty sure.
What was that last tab? Was it borrower? Down the very bottom, you got four tabs down at the bottom. I'm trying to see what the
borrower line.
I had to do two because it would overlay. So I had to do two. So the borrower loan is this populates this section. And the loan minimum term we put here because that populates this section to give the minimum requirements to the underwriter. So if let's change the minimums here, and if somebody comes to the table with, let's say, $100,000, it'll give a red light right there, so the
right.
Operator knows obviously it's not going to work. And if there's a red in that borrower term section at all, they would know not to even go down to the second floor.
So, go ahead. Yeah.
That's great. Awesome. Just a question. The borrower won't view some of the independent of your decision making process here, right?
We built it basically with the idea that where, let's say, the loan committee, and this is being handed to an underwriter, and here you go, plug the numbers in. There's nothing to it. You just plug the numbers in where it's yellow, and it'll give you a red or green light on the top. If any of them are red, it's a no. If they're both green, then you can move down to this section, and that's the second filter with the secondary factors, basically. Because the main factors are going to be your financial, you know, the numbers.
Right.
The bank cares about the numbers more than anything, really.
Is that how high did you go on your debt service coverage ratio? 1.75?
Well, that's the borrower. So in this case.
Well, right.
So this is, if they would have to plug in the NOI of whatever the borrower is bringing to them. Let's, you know, the borrower is going to bring a deal and say, I need a loan for this. So the underwriter then will plug in the numbers, and here they can plug in the NOI. So let's say it's 10,000 again.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, turns it red, and brings it down.
Okay.
Great job.
So, in terms of the direct applicability of this in a practical sort of setting, I mean, where do you see any other holes that you need to fill in, or
the secondary factors are kind of arbitrary, I guess. I mean, we didn't get a lot of time to research specifics. Those were kind of off of our, we threw those in there, and then the weights. If we were to go do it again, I think the weights, I would have added to this info sheet here where somebody can plug in what they think is the most important as far as like a loan committee or somebody above an underwriter. But we kind of just threw the formulas there just to get it done, I guess.
I mean, I love what you did with the property type thing. That really is, I love that piece of it because, you know, obviously there are differences between the property types in terms of the loans are going to be achieved by those. So that definitely is a big selling point of your model. I like that a lot.
Well, when you get terms from a bank, usually they give you the layout of terms for each class of property that you're looking at. So that's kind of where we start. That's what gave us that idea.
Yep. That's great. Other comments, questions?
Good job. Great
job.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we close it out, and we'll see who's next in line.
Excel icon.
No, no, it's already loaded. All you have to do is click on the icon and click the one you want to pull up. There you go. You got it loaded three times. All I have to do is, okay, there you go. Enable editing.
Alright, so like Cash was explaining a little bit, we kind of have a very simple version where we kind of analyze an investment property itself, and we pretty much, so if you see it, there's an analysis of the property, and then we have the credit worthiness of the buyer. So if Cash, if you like click on the change, you know, like on the credit score. So where we set this was like anything credit score below 640 would require a debt ratio of 1.5. Anything over 640 would require a debt ratio of 1.3. And from there, we pretty much just ran the analysis of the property where the purchase price, the units, everything that you see in blue are the inputs. And pretty much everything drops after that. So we just went off of hypotheticals of a 35% down payment. With 65% financing, and from there, where we got our answer is where you don't see that at, is the net operating income required from the credit worthiness. If it's not equal to or greater than the what, if the net operating income at the top for the income expenses is not equal to or greater than the net operating income required, then the deal didn't go through. Based off of 5% vacancy rate, the number of dwellings, the rent per dwelling.
We kind of like thought about it, like, do we want to give it like an option of like servicing everybody, or kind of come up with a model that this is our lending program and you have to meet like these criteria for us to be able to lend to you in regards to the multifamily. We didn't go all the way like you guys and did all kinds of LTVs and stuff like that. I mean, put some formulas in, we try to do it that way. Kind of put a fixed loan portion that we will only give 65%. We will not loan out 75%, for example. So that's why we didn't make that option. We said this is the criteria for us if we want to rent out to multifamily.
Yeah, but that wasn't the assignment. The assignment was to pick 10 different lending criteria and apply weights to those lending criteria.
I thought that the 10 things that we didn't decide, that was the.
Go ahead and finish explaining.
That was pretty much it for the formula to see if the person was approved or not. If the net operating income required in the credit worthiness box was greater than the net operating income that the property produced, then the person was denied the loan.
So basically you've got one criteria out of 10. You're using a credit score and that's it. That's what I'm saying.
Because I thought we already applied like the vacancy rates. Yeah, the debt coverage ratio.
But is that an input or is that a, that looks like that's a fixed field.
Which one?
Debt service coverage ratio.
It will change.
It will change depending on the credit.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's not an input then, that's an output.
And then so pretty much purchase price. So pretty much we looked at the property itself and we evaluated the approval rating of the buyer based off of whatever the property was cash flow. Makes sense. I know we just stayed at the extra 30 minutes. I think that would have helped a lot. Any questions?
Questions? Thank you. It should be there. If you go back down to the icon, and then you may have a choice there to the right.
Okay, so ours also is a very simple one. We didn't get too complex. We made it strictly for office, so we didn't, you didn't get to choose. So we picked criteria, temperate criteria, which after a little bit of research, we found for office underwriting, this is kind of what lenders would look at. The top two being debt service coverage ratio and loan to value, and those are weighted the heaviest. We did drop down. Oh no, we didn't do drop downs for those.
Yeah, we did for.
So those are actual inputs, yeah. And then as you go down, you can see the weight gets less and less and less. We did our factor score on 1 to 5, 1 being the best, 5 being the worst. So the lower your score at the end, the more likely you were to be approved. Our approval range went from 1 to 3, you got a thumbs up, and below 3 was disapproval.
And also we use formulas, the formula of if to determine the range. And we also determine the approval based on a scale of 1 to 5. Anything below 3, and the final weighted score is going to be approved, anything above is going to be disapproved.
So you want a lower score?
Lower score is the better one, yeah. And just to go over a little bit of the criteria, credit history of tenants, we just use the standard FICO score for excellent, good, very good, poor, and that would determine the factor score for there. Vacancy rate, obviously, percentage of unused property.
That's an input.
Mm-hmm. Property condition, the building was brand new. Some of these overlap a little bit too, because obviously class type kind of goes a little bit with property condition. Lease rates versus market lease rates, so what we plan on leasing the building for and what the current market is going for. Management efficiency would be like property management of the building, who's going to run it, how much experience do they have, local employment growth, so is the employment increasing, decreasing, stable, and who obviously is office, and then last but not least we had location, which the closer you are to major transportation or the central business district, the higher score you got. The one thing I wish we would add LEED certification, which I already think of to you guys, is that a pretty good criteria because we're kind of digging for some. But just below we have the criteria definition of each one.
Can you blow those up just a little bit, for the criteria definitions? Just
Oh yeah.
Talk a little bit about management efficiency.
So that would be who would plan on managing the building, property management. So if you have someone or a company, 20 plus years experience, good reviews, a good rap.
We consider a past project.
Yeah, you would have a higher factor score versus somebody who's new, or if you're planning on running it yourself and you don't have any experience, you would have a lower factor score.
I'm confused. I thought we'd the other way around. Didn't you say that you used?
I'm sorry. Yeah. You would get a 5 with less experience.
Yeah. Why did you sort of choose to go in that direction in terms of the lower score is better than the higher score?
Well, initially we were trying to do it based on like kind of like a GPA, like a grade value, and we were confusing ourselves with
one. First place, fifth place, kind of like perspective.
Yeah. Oh, okay, all right. And you said the cutoff for approved versus not approved was what?
3. So if you're 3
below
and up, you got approved. Under 3.
No, wait. If you're 3 and up, you're...
No, you're 3 and up, you're disapproved. You're low 3.
See, this is why it's confusing.
Yeah.
Right?
The
basic
see,
logic, yeah.
1, 2, and 3 approved. 4 and 5 disapproved.
Okay, all right. Fair enough. All right, let's... Go back over there to the to your factors for a second. Okay, so let's see here. What else we've got? Dustin, this is sort of I mean, obviously office buildings is kind of your wheelhouse. I mean, what other factors would you have thought that you would have put in here for underwriting an office building?
Well, it's pretty difficult to underwrite an office building right now because it requires at least 25% pre-lease or pre-sale. So that's a factor that you have to look at as far as it's being built spec by an investor, which has to come up with most of the cash, which will affect your LTV versus residential rental or something like that. Banks are throwing money at people. And as long as the underwritten rents for multifamily meet the market area, there's a whole standing audience of investors. So I guess credit to the tenant and you know, the amount of pre-lease that, you know, is available.
Yeah, pre-lease.
Okay. And I noticed that you guys, unlike the first group, you actually just limited it specifically to the credit history of the tenant and didn't put anything in there about the person seeking the loan, the borrower. And so you want to talk about that at all other than just what kind of already been said?
The credit history of the tenant? I mean, I would have, we didn't think of adding the borrower. I guess thinking the credit history of the tenants would be enough for the underwriter.
I mean, what do you think
about
that?
I mean, after seeing the other presentations, obviously there's stuff that we're like, oh.
Credit of the tenant.
Credit of the tenant versus the borrower. I mean, we talked about it in class as being, you know, that, you know, more of a conscious shift on the part of a lot of the lenders to really looking at the tenants and their sort of credit history versus looking at, you know, how relevant in your mind, based upon what you've seen with the office market. I mean,
well,
is there one that matters more?
A lot of developers fail, you know, or have, you know, they go down with the market cycle. Like Cal Fumo is a guy up in an area where I work in Palm Beach that burned a lot of people and did a lot of bad things and basically was on the run for a little while. But now he's back in the market. It's a different time in the market cycle. And so borrowers can recover from things like that if they have a longer track record of success. So, I mean, it's important as far as their ability to perform. But the credit of the tenant is largely what will dictate the terms you're going to get.
I have a question. It's not necessarily for them. It's probably more for you. But how is the tenant's credit history available for anyone, for, I guess, the landlord to see?
It would be.
Because, I mean, initially when they came on board, right? But say they've been with you for 5 years, their credit score could have changed.
Sure.
Before you go to get out a loan, you have to then go to your tenants and say, I'm taking out a loan, I'm going to need your updated credit score, sort of a thing?
In some cases, absolutely.
And that's not that's available to?
Yep.
Oh, wow.
Is that an ongoing thing for the life of the loan, or is that just the initial tenants if you're a developer?
Every time you're going to be changing tenants, you're going to definitely have to probably pull that.
Okay.
But then, within the duration of the loan, the lender may have a stipulation that they want that information updated once a year, once every 2 years, once every 3 years, whatever they choose to kind of mandate.
Do they have ratios of what you have to keep good versus bad? Because I know that, like, startups, let's say, you know, I mean, there's plazas filled with you know, smaller tenants that are startups.
Yeah, and it really all gets down to that specific lender. I mean, just like you guys are obviously, you know, showcasing here, everybody looks at it a little bit differently. You know, there's not one absolute standardized, you know, approach, you know, to this process. And you know, each lender has kind of come up with their own criteria that they happen to think are the most important, you know, for that maybe particular property type, that particular market, that particular economic cycle, whatever it may be. And ultimately that is going to, you know, factor into their decision-making process. Diego?
Yeah, because I'm new to the industry, I just would like to know, do borrowers have access to audit information or only to certain information regarding the decision-making process of the lenders?
And that's an interesting question, because some lenders are not, actually I would argue that many are not very transparent,
okay,
you know, because they don't want you playing a game. you know, and, you know, it's sort of like if you know precisely what their criteria are and precisely how you're going to be evaluated, then to what extent you try to basically tailor your presentation or your proposal to those terms, and ultimately, as a result, you know, fudge a little bit here and there, and to potentially try to get the loan and not really put forth your most honest effort, I guess.
And what if you felt like it was not honest or?
Well, see, and I guess, you know, are you talking about from the lender's point of view, or are you talking about from the borrower's point of view? From the borrower's point of view, I mean, once again, what's probably going to happen as a matter of practice is if you get turned down by one lender, there's a chance that you still could be approved by another lender. It might just simply be that there are different terms and conditions that are going to be applied to you. You may have a different interest rate, you may have a different term, you may have a different set of fees, you know, and all of that, you know. And it doesn't necessarily mean that the one that you got turned down by is going to give you the best terms. You know, it very well could be the case that you get turned down by the lousiest lender with the lousiest terms, but then potentially get approved by the best lender with the best terms. You know, that's what I'm saying. There's no absolute rhyme or reason. That chances are, if we were to come up with a hypothetical property with hypothetical set of conditions, and we were to put that property into every single one of your underwriting models, you know, there very well could be the case that, you know, it gets turned down by some of them, but then approved by others. You know, but that's the point is that, you know, you've got to understand that every lender, you know, if it's a local lender, yeah, they're going to have their own, you know, sort of specialized criteria. But if it's a you know, a national lender, they probably have a fairly sophisticated model that they're going to put all of this information into and then ultimately spit out, well, okay, here are the terms and conditions. Okay, Kaylin?
On average, like, you know how I went to apply for a commercial loan for a property. It was residential, but it was multifamily, so they look at it as commercial, right? And the loan to value was 1.3, for example, right? So,
you mean the debt service coverage ratio?
It was 1.3. And what happened was, what I wanted to know, like on average, if you are, for example, you're putting down 65%, or they're giving you a loan for 65%, 70%. After that, they also have vacancies, they also have management fees. On average, is it about like 14-15% also deducted from the value that they lend to you? Because, like, say if they give you 65%, but they have all these conditions that mark that down.
Okay, you're talking about haircutting.
Yes.
So basically, what happens whenever an underwriter receives your loan package, they pretty much make the assumption that you're giving them best case scenario. And so they then take that quote-unquote best case scenario situation that you have put forward to them, and they stress test it. And they basically say, you know, you're saying that in this market there's a 95% occupancy for this particular property type, but the majority of the properties within this market really are close to 90%. But we're going to haircut it maybe even a little bit further and go down to 85% whenever we're stress testing your model, just to make sure that if it does happen to go down, we're not going to be...
Yeah, we're covered.
We're covered.
Right.
And so you're absolutely right in that respect that there's, you know, on virtually every criteria, there's a very good chance the lender is going to go through, and they're going to go through that haircutting process of whittling down your income to the point of you're going to get a lower and lower dollar amount loan simply because of that.
Yeah, because when you try to go apply, they're like, okay, they're going to lend me 65%. At the end, you look at it, you're getting 50% max.
Right. No, you know? And that on that point, you are absolutely 100% correct. Okay, Gayon, did you have a question or comment? I thought I saw a hand.
Yeah, this is minor, but for their criteria, is it property condition like a derivative of class type?
That's what I said. They overlap each
okay,
other.
So,
yeah.
Why'd you guys put it in there?
We were trying. 10 criteria.
That's an honest answer. You know.
Yeah.
That's
helpful to know too.
That's why
yeah.
That's why we always said that a LIT certification would be great.
Yeah,
but
I wish we would have found
some. The location, it being your city, does that make a huge difference, like the limiting factor?
When we researched it, it did, yeah, we were researching like underwriting criteria for office, and it said the closer it is to major transportation or the central business district or combined, the higher we'll
like
more likely to be approved, yeah. It helped.
All right. Any other questions? Great, thank you. I'm going to close all of them out. Yep, keep closing. Okay, whoever's next. It should just be down underneath that Excel tab at the bottom. There you go. Nope, oh, that's not you. Where is it? Yes, there we go. Eduardo, can you blow that up a little bit just so I can.
Yep.
And then I guess the enable editing up at the top. Click on that too. That's good, perfect. And then, yeah. Yeah, up there toward the top where it says enable editing.
Okay.
Okay. There we go. Perfect.
Well, mine is similar to the last one. The difference is that, well, I put the factors, and what I think the factors affect, and then the weight, and all the factors have points, to 0 to 100. These points, they are transformed to weight points. For example, here, 20%, 70 points, 14 weighted points. And then the lost points, because you could make it 20 points here, and you made it 14. And I also started with beginning 100% the best client, let's say that. So if you have 100%, it's going to be like 5%, 20 years, it's commercial, 3% prepayment penalty, and there it goes. And from here, you just go up on interest rate, penalties, and fees, and go down in turns. So if you change the points, for example, in property condition, let's see, here, your term is gonna be affected. I didn't make a range like for debt service, for example, 1.3, 1.5, because this is always changing. So it's like a simple model that maybe 70 points could mean 1.3 debt service, but 70 points could be 1.5 in six months from now. So it's pretty easy, pretty simple, and it's based on your lost points. So if you lose points here, for example, and affect the interest rate, you come here, it's gonna be higher. So let's do it again. 37 points. 80. Can actually choose change this. I had to put this in yellow as well because, as I said, it's always changing the market. So this is maybe 4% in 1 year from now, maybe 6. So this column you gotta change as well. Oh, I got the. It's not a definition, but it's why. I think the factors affect interest, origination fees, and everything else.
points, I put 70 points to be approved. Yeah.
So this last one, the lease rates relative to other properties, and you're saying that it affects not determine, so
yeah,
what?
Because I think it's important, but some people, some readings I've read said that it affects the interest rate, but I didn't think that, so I just did, consider that it's not determined to the interest rate.
Okay, so let's just take that in a hypothetical there for a second. So let's say that your lease rates for this property are high relative to other properties. How would you view that? Is that a good thing or a bad thing, and why?
Bad thing.
Okay, why?
Yeah, because probably the market will choose the competition.
Okay, but what if your property is fully occupied? I mean, your lease rates might be higher than everybody else's, but you may actually have higher occupancy. But does that mean that your tenants are overpaying for the space, and that the first chance they get, they're going to leave?
Yeah.
Right.
And location.
No, I'm just asking the question. I'm really not trying to grill you on this. But I'm just trying to, you know, think through the logic on what does that really mean. Does it mean that, you know, if your tenants on average are paying higher than everybody else for comparable space, you know, what is it that, why is that happening? Number one, you know, is because you're doing a better job of leasing in terms of getting those higher rates? Is it that your tenants are uninformed? Is it you're offering some other service? Is it that you happen to lock them in before the market changed in a negative way? You know, and, you know, how does that translate into, you know, value creation you, but more specifically for the lender, how is the lender going to look at that? I mean, what do you think as a class? Yep.
I mean, I think it's dynamic, so it will be changing continuously based on market factors and the factors that you just shared about before.
Yeah, that was the idea, because in this kind of scale, you can change like, all right, the market changed tomorrow. It's pretty simple and pretty easy. I chose this form.
How do you determine the points? Like,
yeah, that's your range. You know? I didn't determine here. Yeah.
So they're all inputs? Or are you just like inputting the range just randomly? I guess
no,
that's a question.
Exactly. Yeah. You have to choose the ranges. I didn't put any ranges.
So the lender, they go, it's a good property. Perfect condition is great. I'm going to give them an 85 or a 90.
Yeah. Okay, exactly.
There's no like.
You have to determine the ranges.
So I love the fact that you did the whole thing of separating out the factors and what they specifically influence. I think that is absolutely a really great insight and a good thing to have done. But, you know, part of the weakness is kind of what we were just sort of talking about, that, you know, in terms of seeing specifically how those points translate to very specific information within the market at this particular point in time, like a couple of the other groups have done, where it showed a range here between here and here, you get this point value, between here and here, you get this point value.
That, I could increase that, put in the ranges, of course.
Yeah, I think that's probably the weakness that I see, because this does allow, it's a bit too subjective in the sense of just simply.
Yeah, too simple, that's it, yeah.
Yeah, and that you're just basically relying on the underwriter to just sort of arbitrarily pull out of the sky, okay, this is the value we should give for this one versus this one. But as I said, I absolutely love the whole thing of separating out which of those criteria are going to influence each of the items, the interest rate, the fees, and the penalty, and that sort of thing. I think that's great. Okay. Other questions, comments?
Good job.
Yeah, great, thank you. And did you not have a partner?
Nope.
Okay.
Thank you.
For ours, we kind of just kept it simple.
Can you blow that up a little bit so I can see it? Thanks. Sorry.
We just, based on the assignment, chose the 10 most significant factors for our property. This can be multifamily, residential, whatever. Beginning with the borrower's income, as you can see, admin fees, loan interest rates, everything else that we decided or determined would be important factors in finding the results.
Yeah. Right, so for the index column, this is like a sample input, and again, this can change. I just put these numbers in here. They can change as needed. We didn't go into including like amounts and, you know, like the other presenters did before us. So this is just like a snapshot of basically where the borrower stands in regards to their income and all these, you know, the 10 criteria that we used. We had ranges, the ideal ranges for each. So some ranges were ideal for them to be scored high on and some for them to be low on. So like we wanted them to be high on borrower income, for instance, but then low on debt to asset ratio. And we assigned the weight, you know, distributed from, you know, from lowest to highest according to the items that we found to be more important in significance. And the score column then we calculated by factoring the score from the index column to the relative weight, and that gave us a range in terms of an answer per each category. So again, on the ones that are high, we wanted them to be between, in this case we considered anything above 7 or 70 to be positive. Anything, you know, also within, like if it had to be low, if it was within the range, you know, if it was low, then positive. If it was high, then it would be negative. I didn't include, and I probably could have added like a decision on a cell where in this case, let's say we have 3 negatives, so that's, we've got 7 out of 10. This would be that they would be approved, but in case it weren't, then, so I didn't add that to this spreadsheet, but.
These are just samples and just numbers that we have put to
find the results. So what's the verbiage that you've got down there below?
Right, the 3 C's, so this is just to understand what capacity was, credit, and a collateral.
Okay, and so go back to the model there for a second, go up. So, in terms of collateral, so explain how your model relates to that one.
So we incorporated that to like your amount for borrowing, so, and we didn't expand it and elaborate each item, but that would sum up what's needed for borrowing and what's being brought in terms of collateral, down payments, any other assets, right? And assign it a score and work that score through all the way to the result.
But I guess what I'm trying to understand is
the correlation between the three and the results.
Yep.
I mean, these are just factors that we consider ourselves are important. Not partially directly. They affect it in a sense, but it's not a direct correlation between all of them. Okay, where are you going with the question?
Okay. So I'm just trying, I guess I'm just sort of confused in why you have that down there other than just.
Oh, just, I was using this as a guideline to the actual charge itself, not as part of the presentation.
Okay.
Yeah. The verbiage can be like removed, erased. It's not.
Okay. Now, in terms of those index values that you've got in column C, so I'm kind of interpreting from this that it's, once it's kind of like Eduardo's model, that we don't really know how you get a 6 or a 4 or a 2 or whatever for each of those index scores. All we're seeing is just a number there. We're not actually, it's not tied to anything in terms of, for example, if I've got a 1.5 debt service coverage ratio, what does that mean?
Right, and it's not here like, did, but we would have worked that in the background. I was just concerned about what we were going to be presenting as a snapshot of the whole, you know, behind the scene where we would have had all that information and gotten a credit rating, we got, you know, would have backed it up like the presentations prior and just broken down by all these different categories.
Okay. All right. Questions?
I'm just curious, the admin fees, as far as that being a factor, I'm just curious how you guys like determined that or picked that.
I mean, it was just one of our factors, like I said, that we just incorporated in there.
Right, because if the admin fees would be high, then that would affect the whole, you know, like the score, the rating at the end. If low admin fees would, you know, give a cushion to then leverage the other categories.
Okay.
So you said you have the three negatives, seven positives, so that'd be 70%. So one more negative, and it'd be like no go, right?
Right. Perhaps, and depending on the borrower and for the type of property, which we're here, but so let's say we would go back and look at these more in depth. So maybe a borrowing, the amount of borrowing, you would be able to borrow less, or they would affect the property conditions, right? The admin fees perhaps would increase because there's more risk in that. Brought in here. These are 10. I mean, I'm sure in real life it would be probably like 100, but.
Yeah, because let's see that you have four negatives, but in related weighting of like 5%, you have in the 10 to 9, 8% in the 8th, and 7, 10% in the 7. It would be like 10, 20, 28. It would be 72%. So it seems like not bad, but really.
Right.
That's why I think that four negatives, not actually you're down.
With four negatives, you wouldn't be down?
Yeah.
And it all depends, right?
Depends on the
it would be made to scale.
Right, so if you were to see the numbers, it goes up to positive or negative, it all depends on the inputs.
So. Yeah, because, I mean, I think this is what you're trying to get at, is that you could very well have seven barely positives,
right,
and then three highly negatives, and you know that's not going to be the same as seven highly positive,
yeah,
and
negative,
three barely negatives. And so, you know, that relative strength or weakness of those is not really kind of self-evident there. I mean, you kind of have it picked up in your score column, but
you know
some sort of an additive model where, you know, once again you would have an actual number attached to that would kind of give some sort of indication of where it fell overall. But more specifically, the big missing piece was, you know, where in the world are those, you know, index values coming from? Because that doesn't really give us enough information. That, for example, if I gave you all of those variables there, and I gave you numbers for each of those for an actual project, you know, how would that translate into you inputting that into your model?
I guess we just didn't incorporate the key, like you're saying, to understanding the numbers of what we chose. We just
no, yeah. Right, and we would have had all the information backed up. I think, like I said, just
all right. Anybody else? Questions? Comments? Okay. Thank you very much.
I kind of have a question for you. If you're an instance and you're going to a lender and say this is a scenario where you plug in all your terms and they would give you their ideal LTV on the loan based on what you plugged in, would that percentage also include sort of the hairline costs, or would like admin fees, loan origination fees, would they be in addition to that LTV?
It's going to depend.
Oh, okay.
Just on the absolute.
Okay.
We didn't make ours too complicated, so we're just excited.
All right.
we prepare our spreadsheet and take consideration multifamily investments, income properties. In this case, well, here we put 10 criteria. This is the front door of our system, and this is the back door of our system, where we put all our criteria, all the lenders' criteria. We put the discovery ratio, we put the down payment. We only receive at least 30% of down payment. That means that for loan to value, at least.
The slider over a little bit so I can see, make it larger down there to the bottom. The little slider for the how big it is.
No, zoom into the screen.
The zoom.
Oh, yeah.
Zoom. Down at the bottom there. There we go.
Okay. In the back door, we as our lenders, we put our criteria. And so here we have the first one is the debt service coverage ratio. The minimum is 120. Less than 119, for example, is not allowed. So we put a weighting of 0. Our weighting criteria is points, not percentage. So we're taking 250 points, and that's over 100%. So, for example, here at the very bottom, we have that minimum is 170 points, that's 70%, and 250 is over 100%. The criteria are, the weighting are divided in 0, 10, 20, and 25. Being the 25 points, the highest one. And for example, here in the debt service coverage ratio, above 1.3, we have the highest weighting of 25. So the down payment, as I said before, the minimum is 30%, loan to value, 70%. The operating expenses, the minimum is 30%. 40% for 35 and above, 0. The vacancies is the same, or above 15% of vacancies is 0, and 5%, 4% or less is 25, is the highest value. The land value. We have two criteria here. Land value relative to project and year of build. We take both. It doesn't matter because maybe we're lending money to an old property, but even if it's in bad conditions or it's too old, it is in a good location. So we take consideration both criteria.
Yeah, the year it was built.
And the land value, yes.
Relative to the project value.
Okay, stop. Please explain to me the logic.
Not the logic, but the
reason for the year built in terms of the selection of that particular time frames. Because 1980 was a really long time ago in terms of, and you're saying that that's the best, that something built after 1981 is
25 points.
Yeah, no, I get that, but I mean, to me, I would think you would want it built, like if I were a lender, I would want it built within the past, let's say 5 to 10 years. And and if it was that old, I'm thinking, okay, well, it's gonna have all kinds of issues and problems. I mean, I guess I'm just curious as to why you went back so far.
I was born in 1981. The land value is high.
The reason we did it that way is because properties below the 80s usually have a lot of problems, and even the water systems, or they can have asbestos or different types of construction issues. But most of the properties above the 80s or in the 80s are in good conditions. That's in general, not in all situations.
That's the only one I'm really just like, I'm not really agreeing with.
Yeah. The way these was.
I love, and don't get me wrong, that's the only thing I'm not really agreeing with. I love, you know, what you did in terms of, that you picked quantitative variables that were very measurable. I love that, obviously. You know, so, but that particular one just, it just threw me for a loop because I'm just like, that just seems like a really odd selection of years.
Okay. I'll put a note on that.
So, in regards to that, in regards to the same year build, what year was it that the hurricane laws came into effect that everything has to be, like, hurricane shutter, 1978 or something?
No, it was much later than that.
92.
Exactly.
It was at 1992.
Yeah. So I guess that could have been, like, a good platform that you could have used beforehand, I guess.
Maybe.
I don't know.
Maybe I made a mistake, but maybe that was for example, in Venezuela, a year, 30 years old property is still, you know, good. Concrete properties, you know, solid properties, so maybe that's why.
Yeah, it's only one single.
We're thinking, okay, 35 years old for a multi-family, it's not so far.
Okay.
So in our model, as Jesus said, we chose 10 different factors. Every factor, as you can see, has 4 different tiers, and depending on the number that you place in the input cells, and that's gonna be within a tier, and if you are, let's say, in tier 2, that's gonna be 10 points.
Yep.
So the lender is gonna change this as he wants to.
Yep.
As you can see, in every tier, there's one or more conditions.
Yep.
For example, in tier 1, there's 2 conditions, less than or equal. Actually, all of them have 2 conditions. So I use a different function on the borrower worksheet to reflect all those conditions. Let me show you what I did here in the functions. So this is for debt coverage ratio. So
one point.
So if C5, C5, this cell right here is 1.9. Yeah, 1.19 or less, then it's gonna be 0.
Yep.
And then if C5 is greater, but less than or equal than C7,
yep,
which is 1.25,
yep, it gives it a weighting of 10.
Then it's gonna be 10%.
Yep, no, I got
10 points.
Yep.
So I added that new function to have all these factors, I mean all these conditions.
Oh, I love it, that's great. Mind. Well, you did a great job on that.
Thank you.
Okay. An example. So as Jesus said, we didn't take into account percentages. We have points in this model, so the maximum points you can get is 250, and the minimum to get a loan approved is 170. We can consider all types of properties, office, multifamily. It doesn't matter. But we are a little strict with our lender criteria, so we are not gonna lend money to just anyone. We are looking for the jumbo deals, like good deals. So let's do one example right here. This is where the lender is gonna evaluate a specific borrower. So let's say
1.2.
Let's say I'm the lender and a borrower comes to me with this deal. So let's say the deal has 1.3 DSCR, yeah. And he's gonna put a down payment of 45%. As I put the data, I get different relative weightings and factor scores. Now, the factor scores don't determine the ability of the borrower to get a loan approved. It only tells you if that factor is satisfactory in our criteria. What is actually going to determine if the borrower gets a loan is a relative weighting, the total relative weighting right here.
So, okay, in that last column, the column, I guess it's F, where it has unsatisfactory.
Yeah.
I guess I'm confused. So is that individual factor specific or is that overall?
No, that's factor specific. Yeah,
okay, so how is it if I'm putting down 45%, that's not a good thing?
Should be satisfactory. Hmm. Yeah.
don't know what it's not. That might be right. 70% of loan.
Wow.
70%. That's what that means.
70% of
yeah.
Loan.
70%.
Mm-hmm. Loan
to
value?
Nope.
No. Yeah, that's not he was giving me.
Okay, that's
29.
Okay,
listen.
Just
29? Yeah.
Yeah,
it's not changing for.
Yeah,
so
yeah. Okay, alright.
I apologize on that.
Keep going. It's
okay,
fair.
So let's say down payment is 45%. Let me see the formulas are working. I remember that was working before. Was that new data?
It doesn't matter. That's good going.
Okay.
It matters that it's proof or not.
Yeah. So the operating expenses as percentage of EGI,
30%.
Yeah, that's set to 100% because you know as you go down,
right,
get more weighting. So let's say it's 30%. And now let's say that in vacancies, we have only 5% vacancies. And our land value relative to project value is around 35%. Okay, and the year of bill is 1981. And then the property condition is 9 out of 10. Our cap rate is 9.5%. And we are located in the location we are only considering Broward County, Palm County, Palm Beach County, or Miami-Dade County.
So I didn't see that one in the scoring system. So how are you weighting those in terms of?
Okay, so.
So basically, Miami is best, followed by.
Yeah, we're looking mostly for properties in Miami.
Mm-hmm.
And the least in our consideration is Palm Beach County.
Any bigger logic behind that?
There's actually no.
For us, it's
the specific logic. We just like more Miami for, I don't know, we just like it more Miami.
We know more the market in Miami.
Yeah, exactly. We know more the market in Miami. So let's say I chose Miami in my model, and the FICO score for this person is 700. So once you put all the borrowers' data, you get a weighting.
So okay, let's just take the Miami thing. It looks like you put in Miami, which is supposedly your best choice, and it's giving you a -1 as your factor score.
I think the issue is because you have a -1 as the false statement. Like, go into your formula and just delete the -1 in parentheses. It's in there.
Yeah, it should be -1.
And also the quotations as well. Or just one, actually.
Determines if you get approved or not.
And depending on the point, is the interest rate?
Yeah, depending on how many points you get, you get different long terms. So
long terms, rates, and
exactly.
And prepayment fees.
So exactly. So if you get the minimum total points of 170 to get a loan, you get not so good long terms. And as you get more points, you get better terms. If I change, for example, these to 250, see, I get better terms. I get lower interest rate, more amortization, less administrative fees, less prepayment fees, and lower operating fees.
And so, what are the logic segments in there? I mean, did they change those? In other words,
yeah.
In other words, for the outputs, what is it that specifically is are all of them changing simultaneously?
Yeah, they all change simultaneously depending on the total.
I mean, what I'm trying to get at is the relative change of, what's the formula that you're using to get those numbers to go up or down is what I'm trying to get at.
Is the formula that I'm using. So, can you see it? Well, I'm going to change these to these because it's not really easy to see. So
basically it falls within a certain range. Okay.
So, yeah, all these formulas in the factors depend on the point, on the cell D16.
Gotcha.
So if D16 is, you know, you can see a formula at the top, that's conditions.
Let me try to, I'm not trying to belabor this, but let's say that the score is between 200 and, I don't know, 250.
Yeah.
Then is it going to, versus, let's say, 250 or 260, is the each one of the items down below, are they going to change? In other words, they have different ranges for each one.
Yeah, different ranges. Mm-hmm. All right.
They do?
They do, yeah.
Okay, that's what I was trying to get at. Okay.
Yeah, for example, this one has six conditions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for each one, you get there's six conditions. So you have to be in that range to be, you know, to get a number or a percentage.
But it's the same range for each one. Is that what you're saying, or are they different ranges? I can't see from back here, honestly.
Well, no, you have different ranges. No, sorry, you have the same range.
Okay, that's what I was asking.
Same
okay,
range.
Okay.
Same range.
Okay. All right. Because I guess my point being is, you would, if you've got them at the same range, my concern would be the relative change as that overall total changes. Would you not want there to be?
I made it all equal, so there's no.
Okay.
No
relative weighting is what I guess it's
yeah,
trying to.
Yeah.
Okay.
No
all right. Fair enough. All right. Move on.
They're all worth the same.
Gotcha.
So that's pretty much. Oh. Yep, that's it.
Okay, what's that verbiage you get over to the right on that model there?
To the right?
Yeah, far right.
Oh, that's the explanation. Last class you said you wanted to have the explanation on Excel, so I wrote it down.
Can you blow it up a little bit so I can, okay, there we go. Gotcha, okay, I see. Okay, great, thank you very much.
Okay.
Questions? Anybody?
Say that again?
Any questions?
No, I thought on your go back to your debt service coverage ratio and how you weighted it. I thought you did a good job on that.
Oh, thank you, Paul.
No, well, go back and show it because it's relevant.
Yeah, you want to see it. Well,
there.
It's on the first worksheet.
I think
the
that's
front
a great
door or the back door. This is the back door. Yeah, that's the back door. So
no, I understand, but the way you weighted it. And
how
it's relevant. I would have put loan to value in there as well, but
yeah,
but no, you did a good job with that. I like what you did.
Other comments, questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Good job.
Thank you. Okay, I guess no more. People present,
yep.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh, with
that?
Okay. Yeah.
Did you send it to me
via email? Yeah.
Was
submitted yesterday.
I said
last night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What?
I got mine on here.
No, that's fine. Go ahead.
Thank you.
right? So this is our model for different factors that are going
Can you blow it up just a little bit before you get started?
Sure. Yeah.